We've talked about object storage, so let's talk about MinIO object storage. What exactly are you getting with MinIO? What makes us the better choice compared to other offerings out there? Well, MinIO provides an enterprise-grade feature set. And what I mean here is that we're not just S3 compatible. We build out for S3 compatibility and we do extensive testing to ensure that our behavior very closely matches that of S3, meaning it's not just that our request and response bodies in the S3 API match, we test and ensure that the underlying behavior also matches. We want it to look as indistinguishable as possible. So if your clients are writing against Amazon S3 or MinIO, they shouldn't be able to tell a difference. But we go quite a bit farther than that. We implement features like object locking or object retention for being able to protect objects for regulatory or compliance reasons. We support single sign-on through the OpenID Connect protocol or Active Directory LDAP, so you can have external identity management through any number of identity providers, and this gets you that single sign-on integration. We have full support for encryption, including the AWS bucket and object encryption standards, meaning server-side encryption. But we extend that by supporting other key vaults, so not just the Amazon Key Management Service. We also support things like HashiCorp Key Vault or Google Secret Manager. We support Lambda Compute, specifically through our bucket event notification service. We support a number of outputs, various meshes brokers like RabbitMQ or Kafka. And then there's a generic webhook endpoint as well, so you can push bucket events to your own customized webhook that can do any number of transformations or responses that in turn trigger other code. So this is our answer to the Amazon Lambda Compute. We've implemented something called Erasure coding. This is an object granularity level resiliency and healing system. We take all of the drives in the deployment and shard objects across drives in certain sets. And the idea is that depending on your configured parity, you can lose up to half the number of drives in the deployment and still be able to read data back and heal. And all of this healing is handled automatically. You don't need RAID or ZFS pools or any other sort of hardware or software level drive healing or management. In fact, this is why we often say with MinIO we want JBOD, just a bunch of disk arrays, is because we already handle the disk level or drive level protection and resiliency. We support object lifecycle management, meaning that you can set certain behaviors around either expiring or transitioning objects to another storage tier based on how long those objects have existed on your MinIO deployment. So this allows you to control effectively the cost of storing data over time. And finally, we support something called server-side bucket replication, and we have both bucket and site-level replication protocols. And the idea here is that we fully support through this model use cases like business continuity or disaster recovery, where you have a site A as your primary and a site B as your secondary. And using something like a global load balancer, you can very quickly fail over between sites, and MinIO handles synchronizing data between the two sites. You can also do things like geographically local reads across a globally distributed set of MinIO deployments. So you could have a North American MinIO site, a European MinIO site, a Southeast Asian MinIO site, and use some sort of a global load balancer to tie them all together. Many of these features implement the underlying S3 protocol associated to them. So things like object locking, encryption, object lifecycle management, and the single sign-on use S3 APIs. So again, if you're already using these features on S3, you can continue to use them on MinIO using the same APIs. We tend to extend what Amazon provides because we're not locked into the AWS ecosystem, and we don't have certain restrictions around things like global unique bucket names. And this allows you to do a little bit more than what you would be able to with just S3. Now, the idea with MinIO is to center it within your architecture. We consider ourselves to be primary storage in modern deployments. What that means is because of the S3 compatibility layer, and then adding to that our enterprise-grade feature set, we can effectively meet all of the storage requirements of your applications. So you can have streaming data coming in through something like Kafka or FluentD or RabbitMQ or any other sort of message broker or queuing program that gets stored in MinIO. This data could be processed using ETLs, extract, transform, load scripts, machine learning such as TensorFlow, data processing such as Spark or Presto, all of them have some level of S3 compatibility, meaning they can read and write or just use MinIO as their intermediate storage for processing data. And since MinIO can effectively sit like this at the center, you don't need to manage multiple large data storage or object storage infrastructures or resources. You can generally rely on MinIO to be the only one, or the, again, primary one within your infrastructure. And this greatly reduces the cost and complexity of your deployments because you only really have to focus on the one thing when it comes to storage. And again, because we don't have restrictions on hardware or going through specific vendors or anything along those lines, there's no lock-in that you have to worry about. You can effectively do what you need to do within the MinIO deployment, scale it as you need to based on the available hardware at that time. So let's talk about the inside of a MinIO server. MinIO runs on a variety of hardware architectures. We fully support consumer-level server boxes all the way through the enterprise gear. And as you can see from the table, which just describes a bare minimum for what we would recommend in a production deployment, we can work just fine with consumer-grade processors, and we have a relatively small memory footprint in comparison to the amount of storage. Specifically, when it comes to CPUs, that tends to control the performance around things like encryption, whether it's TLS encryption per connection, or object encryption, or things like erasure coding, which require some level of hashing. Memory tends to constrain the maximum number of concurrent connections per node. So this doesn't have to scale with the amount of storage you have. You can have a relatively small amount of memory and have terabytes or petabytes of storage depending on the number of concurrent connections per node. And this is something you can monitor over time and scale your memory up or down as needed. Since system memory tends to be pretty expensive, this can be a significant cost savings. The key performance points don't tend to reside on the compute layer. It's actually usually the network first, followed by storage. And for storage, we generally classify NVMe as high performance, SSDs as balanced performance, and HDDs, or spinning disks, as cost effective and low performance. Now the reason that this matters is because some networks simply will not be able to keep up with the speed of your storage. MinIO can push your drives as fast as they can possibly go. So even with a relatively small cluster, let's say 4 nodes with 4 drives each, that's still 16 drives worth of throughput that MinIO can aggregate together. This is, even with spinning disks, more than sufficient to saturate a smaller network. 1 or 10 gigabit Ethernet networks will simply be a bottleneck in even the smallest deployments. This is why we tend to recommend 25 gigabit as a minimum, and 100 gigabit is almost a requirement for NVMe because of the speed of those drives tend to completely saturate those networks very quickly. It's unlikely that the storage controller is going to get in the way, but if you are using either budget or consumer level storage controllers that have limited throughput, that could be a problem before the network is. That said, this is generally the order that we tend to see when it comes to performance constraints. It's very rarely on the MinIO side, it usually starts with the network. When it comes to the topology of a deployment, we try to keep it simple. You have some amount of direct attached storage, meaning this is not NAS or SAN or NFS or anything that goes over the network. Each node has some direct attached storage using something like a JBOD, just a bunch of disks, or HBA card. A production MinIO deployment consists of at least 4 of these such hosts with their direct attached storage, which pool compute and storage resources into a single aggregated object storage resource. There's no distinction between your data, compute, or routing nodes. There are other storage services out there in which you have to deploy a dedicated storage node and then a dedicated data node, one for just keeping the data and the other for keeping track of where the data is. Another model would be something like a centralized router, where the router knows where everything is and handles pushing objects wherever they need to go. With MinIO, each server has a complete picture of the distributed topology. An application can connect and issue operations against any node in the deployment and then perform S3 operations. MinIO handles the routing internally and then returns the response to the application. Now, we will typically see a load balancer placed in front of the MinIO storage. This both simplifies the path for applications, they just specify the load balancer address, while being able to take advantage of the fact that load balancers have configurable settings around how it chooses where the next connection should go. We tend to recommend a least connections methodology so you can avoid hotspotting across the MinIO deployment. MinIO has set a standard for performance. Just because we've built things to be simple in terms of the topology or the required hardware doesn't mean that we've given anything up. We run your disks as fast as they can possibly go. And what that means is if you look at our benchmarks, you will consistently see top of the line performance. Now, our benchmarks include everything you need to reproduce them. We don't really hold anything back. You can see the specific kinds of machines that were deployed, the configurations that were used, and the benchmarks that we ran in particular. There's nothing that we feel the need to hide behind here. These are real numbers that we were able to achieve using modern, available hardware that anyone can have access to.